Listening Library presents Where Are the Constellations? By Stephanie Sabol. Read for you by Jennifer Sun Bell. For Adam and Maya, My Stars, SS. For Brian J. and Philip, LAC. Where Are the Constellations? Thousands of years ago, there were no calendars or clocks as we know them. People couldn't tell time by glancing at their cell phones. Instead, they looked for clues in the sky, most often by looking at stars, to tell them what time of day or even what time of year it was. The ancient Egyptians, for example, eagerly waited for a certain star to appear. Once it did, it meant the flooding of the Nile River was about to start. When the flood receded, the soil was fertile and ready for planting crops. There were also no accurate maps. However, the ancient Greeks noticed that one star always appeared in the same place. We call it the North Star, or Polaris, Polar Star. Sailors used it as a guide to help them figure out in which direction they were heading. Today, in cities, lights and pollution blot out many stars. However, on a clear night, a person who is in the country can see thousands. Still, finding one star among thousands can be hard. So long ago in different cultures, people looked for groups of stars, and they imagined them forming pictures by drawing lines from one star to another. It was like a connect-the-dots puzzle today. These pictures were easier to spot than just one star. Each picture was given a name and told a story. Different cultures had different names and stories for the same group of stars. To people in North America, a group of seven stars looked like a long-handled soup spoon. They called it the Big Dipper. Dipper is a word for this kind of soup spoon. However, in England, the same stars were known as the Great Plow. A plow, P-L-O-U-G-H, more commonly spelled P-L-O-W, plow, in the United States, is a farming tool that breaks up soil. In Germany, the stars were known as the Great Cart. Star pictures are known as constellations. The scientific study of stars and everything else in the sky is called astronomy. Astronomers of the 21st century know far more about the stars than ancient peoples did. They have learned what stars are made of, how long they live, and how they die. Yet despite all that has been discovered, even astronomers, just like everyone else, still look to the night sky with the same sense of wonder. Chapter 1. Our Address in Space. Space. What is it? Well, it's everything in the sky that is above Earth's atmosphere, a layer of gases that is about 60 miles thick. Nobody knows exactly how big space is, but it's enormous, really too big for our minds to grasp. So, it's helpful to think of Earth as having an address in space, just like when a person has an address where they live. Earth, the planet we live on, is part of our solar system. Our solar system contains eight planets that orbit, circle, just one star, the Sun. A star is a ball of hot gas, mostly hydrogen and helium. Even though the Sun seems huge to us, it's actually a medium-sized star. And since it's 93 million miles away from us, it's the closest star to Earth. During the day, the light from the Sun is so bright, it blocks out other stars. But at night, after the Sun has set, many other stars in the sky can be seen. Our solar system is part of a galaxy, a city of stars. There are many galaxies. Our galaxy is known as the Milky Way. It was named because of the whitish hue it gives off that looks like milk spilled across the sky. It contains at least 100 billion stars. the Milky Way looks like a pinwheel with four long arms. Our solar system is located in one of the four arms. It orbits around the center of the Milky Way at about 515,000 miles per hour. Even at that very fast speed, it will take our solar system 230 million years to orbit all the way around the Milky Way's center. Dinosaurs roamed our planet the last time our solar system was in this spot. What is bigger than a galaxy? A group of galaxies. The Milky Way is part of a cluster of more than 30 galaxies called the Local Group. This group contains the Andromeda Galaxy. Of big galaxies, it is the one closest to the Milky Way. The Andromeda Galaxy is twice as wide as the Milky Way. Scientists predict that in the next few billion years, the two galaxies will collide and form a supergalaxy. As big as the Local Group is, it's just a small part of a larger group of galaxy clusters called the Virgo Supercluster. It's an enormous collection of more than 2,000 galaxies. These galaxies are all part of our universe. The universe includes everything: Earth, our solar system, the Milky Way galaxy, and beyond. The universe is everything in space that we can and can't see. How did the universe start? No one knows for sure, but astronomers have an idea, or theory. It's called the Big Bang Theory. This theory originally stated that 13.8 billion years ago, the entire universe was packed into a tiny point that was much smaller than the period at the end of this sentence. This point contained tiny particles that were mixed with light and energy. The particles were extremely hot and packed together. In just an instant, they began to expand. This expansion is known as the Big Bang. It was the beginning of space and time. The particles would eventually become what we know as the planets and stars and everything else. The universe still continues to expand today, just like a balloon does when it is blown up. But scientists continue to update this theory as they observe and collect more data. The story of Andromeda. Andromeda was a princess in an ancient Greek myth. She was the daughter of Queen Cassiopeia. Queen Cassiopeia believed that her daughter was more beautiful than the daughters of the sea god Poseidon. That made the sea god so angry, he wanted to destroy the queen's land. What was Cassiopeia to do? She asked an oracle, a person who was able to communicate directly with the gods. The oracle said the only way to gain the sea god's forgiveness was to sacrifice her daughter. So the queen changed Andromeda to a rock by the ocean, where a sea monster named Cetus would come and kill her. Luckily, however, a brave young man named Perseus was passing by. He offered to slay the sea monster in return for Andromeda's hand in marriage. Perseus defeated the sea monster and did indeed marry Andromeda. Chapter 2. Star Tracking. One of the early records of star tracking began in 350 BC. A Chinese astronomer named Shi Shen noted about 800 stars that could be seen with the naked eye. He compiled these into one of the first known star catalogs. Very little is known about Shi Shen. He worked with another Chinese astronomer, Gan De. Gan De is said to have observed Jupiter and what he thought might be a small reddish star next to it. Likely it was one of Jupiter's moons. Shi Shen and Gan De are important because they were two of the earliest astronomers from the East to record their findings. About 450 years later, Greek astronomer Claudius Ptolemy was born. Ptolemy lived in Egypt when it was part of the Roman Empire. Around the year AD 150, he wrote the Almagest. In the Almagest, Ptolemy identified more than 1,000 stars that made up 48 constellations. He chose names for the constellations based on Greek mythology, as well as animals and objects that were commonly known to the ancient Greeks. For example, he named one constellation Pegasus, after a legendary white-winged horse. Pegasus struck his foot against a rock and created...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.